Dear ladies and gentlemen, good day to all of you and very welcome to this webinar. Today we will discuss the topic, the physical consequences for COVID-19 patients. And I think it's fair to say that at this moment on a worldwide level, we are suffering from COVID-19 and the coronavirus. Is there a cure for this disease? Not until there is a vaccine available. And for that time, we thought that it's better to focus on what can we do in terms of treatment. How does this disease proceed? In what phases will patients come? And it's therefore that we started to build a platform like 4 or 5 weeks ago, together with product management and marketing, and of course also our sales department. We have tried to gather knowledge on what is the time frame between the critical phase and the next phases. And in that sense, today, in terms of the physical consequences for COVID-19, we will mainly focus on the ICU possibilities, because the ICU is the most critical phase where we see a lot of people even dying on this terrible disease. And I hope that the structural way of looking at the phases and the possibility for treatment will benefit you in that terms that you can communicate with your clients about what are the possibilities and how can we assist in at least helping a little bit. So the outline for this webinar will be the introduction, the physical consequences of COVID-19 in terms of what can we do in physiotherapy and rehabilitation, the treatment timeline, and also the treatment timeline in the ICU. Then we will discuss the critical illnesses and the ICU-acquired muscle weaknesses. And the last slide will be the post-ICU corona complications and possibly the treatments that we can offer there. What can I say about the introduction? I think it's fair to say that we all know what is currently terrorizing our globe. So we speak about the current coronavirus. It's causing the disease COVID-19. Symptoms often resemble a cold at first and a severe pneumonia in an advanced phase, with also high temperature raises. So basically we can speak of a new lung disease, and it's often referred to as corona obstructive lung disease or COVID associated lung disease. I like the last one a little bit better, because the obstructive part is not always present in COVID-19, but obviously we have to take care for it. Now, when we look at the work of Dr. Heshui Shi in China, he is actually the radiologist of the Science and Technology University of Wuhan, and he was taking CT scans of more than 80 patients, where he was looking at the lungs, and he saw that there was a far-reaching fibrosing of the lungs. And although there is no immediate necessity for airway clearance, it must not be neglected. But what was important is the optimization of ventilation. So it seems that the lungs cannot function well in terms of the uptake of oxygen. And this is basically the first physical consequences of COVID-19 patients. We see a permanent lung damage as a result of scar tissuing. Therefore, shortnesses of breath, even during minimal effort. You can imagine when there is so much scar tissue in the lungs, there is not a total capacity. And then something else comes along, a serious decrease in muscle mass and muscle force. This basically has not so much to do with the COVID-19, but the more in the admission on the ICU. What we see and what we learned in gathering all the information on COVID-19 is that the average stay of a COVID-19 patient at the ICU is 23 days. And I would like you to think about that, because it's twice as long as the normal duration for an ICU admittance. So you can imagine that these people are twice as long as normal admission in a bed, under ventilation, under narcosis, etc., etc. This will cause a lot of physical consequences. What can we do when we build a platform on COVID-19? First of all, we checked the Dutch Association for Physiotherapy because we are closely bound to them. And the physical therapy for hospitalized patients was based on the support on breathing, improving physical functioning, confidence in recovery, reducing anxiety, and reducing the risk of complications. These were, in general, their predictions. When we saw that and when we gathered the other information, it was our marketing department together with product management who built a platform which is based on the COVID-19 treatment timeline. And I think it's a very pragmatic way on looking at the COVID-19 trajectory, because we see very severe three phases of illnesses. We see at first the intensive care admission of the patient. This is, of course, very critical care. People are under narcosis and kept in an artificial coma. And this is for an average of 23 days. Again, this is a very long time to be in the ICU. And given the situation where the patient is in, they have to deal as well with the COVID-19 and as well with a number of symptoms that are related to the ICU admittance. In this first part, basic physiotherapy can be done in first with passive motion to keep the joints flexible, to also maintain range of motion, but also a very important part, what we learned from the academic hospitals in Holland, is muscle stimulation or neuromuscular electrical stimulation to maintain the muscle power and the muscle force for these patients. Then the second two stages, when we look at the early rehab, we see that the patients are still hospitalized. And this is still a trajectory what can go on for weeks. And also there we see that that muscle stimulation is a very important factor, but also while they are off the ICU and basically able to mobilize, low intensity training can start. And then the peripheral rehabilitation, if you take a look at the timeline, then you see that this can take months to even years, because it's very difficult for these people to get back to a normal pattern of functioning. Also, muscle stimulation is indicated, but here we will start also with guided intensity training. And of course, there is a lot of possibilities there in terms of medical training therapy. So this is the COVID-19 treatment timeline, and for now, in this webinar, we will mainly focus on the critical care timeline. And in that sense, we will focus a little bit more on the COVID-19 treatment timeline at the ICU. The development of complaints depend on the duration and the nature of immobilization. You must imagine that these patients are for over 3 weeks completely bed dependent. They are sedated, which means that they are kept in an artificial coma. And once they wake up, you will see a severe delirium due to the anesthetics. Also, the duration of ventilation is a huge problem, because as soon as people get intubated, we will see a number of complications occur. So we see side effects as thrombosis because of the time that they are spending in the ICU not doing anything. We see the possibility of embolism due to the thrombosis. And we see things coming up like dysphagia, where people have severe swallowing disorders just because they had a huge tube in their windpipe. And there is a couple of more, but I think I will highlight them also in the next slide. So what we now speak of is the critical illnesses and ICU-acquired muscle weaknesses. This is sheerly based on ICU admittance. This has nothing to do with the coronavirus or the COVID-19 disease. So basically, as soon as the COVID-19 patients are being admitted to the ICU, we see a secondary disease coming up, and this is called the critical illnesses, the sheer complications that occur once they are admitted to the ICU. Muscle atrophy and loss of muscle mass develop rapidly during critical illness. even within hours of the patient being intubated and mechanically ventilated, you see this already happening. It's therefore that we saw that when the average admission of the ICU is 23 days, you can imagine what that does to the physical possibilities of this patient. The critical illnesses and the ICU-acquired muscle weaknesses, the cause of muscle weakness can be in the muscle and nerves, which are called the polymyopathy for the muscles and the polyneuropathy for the nerves. It's very difficult to differentiate what is exactly the reason, and it's therefore that the professionals came with the intensive care unit acquired weaknesses or the ICU acquired weaknesses. What are the main objectives of these critical illnesses? In all cases, functional improvement in order to achieve easier transfer from bed to chair, to standing positions, even balancing. And you can imagine that transfers can be made from bed to chair, to wheelchair, from wheelchair to bathroom, etc., etc. But you can also imagine that when people are in the ICU, there is nothing you can do. So there is a very severe difference in what phase is the patient. But we can speak of an improvement of the muscle function in general, which is very, very important. Okay, so this is the first part of the webinar, and I think that we want to share the discussion, we want to share the knowledge with each other. So if there are questions now, you can see at your profile, you can see that there is a microphone. If you click on the microphone, then Sandra will try to give everybody that has a question the possibilities to ask the question. So I am now going to wait what will come in.
On the chat, there is no question. Yes, there's one question.
We see that there is one question. And
he's gone now.
Oh, and it's also gone now.
No.
Okay, people, we will be waiting for a little bit more, and then you must understand that there will be a second round of possibilities to ask questions. So in that sense, if there are no questions, Sandra, then I will proceed.
Yeah, we will proceed.
Okay, we go back to the presentation now. And please remember that the last slide was all about these critical illnesses. And the sheer muscle loss that we see during this phase. One of the most important things in neuromuscular electrical stimulation is that it will happen as soon as possible. Start as early as possible during the acute phase of ICU admittance. Stimulation will prevent massive muscle tissue loss, and it will also make sure that in the next phases, the patients will be getting better a lot quicker as if you have done nothing. Because we can take it for granted that 60 to 70% of the muscle quality is lost during the ICU treatment. And the thing, people, is that it can be done with literally all electrotherapy machines of Enrafnonius worldwide that are already there. We have sold so many machines in the last 40 years. If there is a TENS modality in the machine, we can basically set up a program where the normal muscle stimulation can take place on every part of the world at any patient that is admitted to the ICU. So keep that in mind, that that there is already so much possible with every part of the phase and the possible treatments in that phase. We do deploy, though, the Endomed 484 in the ICU because we can offer pre-programmed user protocols. We can perform the treatment on the precise and desired location on both extremities and muscles, and that at the same time. So that is a very big advantage. And another advantage is that the machine is battery operated. Maybe you think, why is that an advantage? Well, I think when you work on an ICU, you must keep in mind that it's a very thoughtful thing to do, to put the machine in the seal bag, let the electrodes come out, because upon going onto the ICU, you can still disinfect the machine and you can go into the ICU safely without harming the patients of the surrounding caregiving people. So how does those Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I just heard that that I was out for a little bit. So I will do this slide again.
Moet je hem ook?
Deze slide is goed, ja, ik hoor het.
Oké, goed, gaan we verder.
Okay.
We'll continue.
Yeah, we'll continue. So a total of 8 disposable entrode electrodes are placed on the target muscles, 2 pairs on the quadriceps femoris, and 2 pairs on the calf muscles, as you can see in the picture. So what does the protocol look like? We have a symmetrical biphasic square pulse with a pulse duration of 400 microseconds, with a ramp up time of 1 second, with a hold time of 6 seconds, a ramp down time of 1 second, and an 8 second pause. Prior to this exact protocol, there should be a continuous warm up at 3 minutes at 5 hertz frequency. The intensity should be individual tolerance or where visible contraction, if the patient is not aware, if it's under artificial narcosis, and each session therefore lasting 18 minutes. The frequencies is 75 hertz, which is a high frequency neuromuscular electrical stimulation, or a 15 hertz, a low frequency neuromuscular electrical stimulation. The 75 hertz is a relative high frequency for the quadriceps femoris muscles because they are more of a phasic muscle. They need a higher frequency to be fully contracted. And the calf muscles are more tonic muscles. Therefore, you require a low frequency. So that explains a little bit why the academic hospitals, at least in Holland, are using these totally different frequencies. I hope that I explained that right. Now, to come to one of the last slides, I think now that one of the most important things is that this coronavirus is already a very severe disease when you look at the COVID-19 disease that comes from corona. So in the first stage, we now discussed a little bit the possibilities that can be on an ICU level. And of course, in the next webinar, we will discuss the follow-ups on the early rehab, what to do in the hospitalized time. We still have a different strategy for the early rehab and the peripheral rehabilitation, but like I said, that will be in the next webinar. Then when we look at the summary, then I think it's fair to say that we try to communicate with you about the 3 phases of COVID-19 rehabilitation. We try to separate those phases because they come along with different treatments. And I think when you keep in mind that in the first phase, it's not only the COVID-19 admission, the COVID-19 disease, but also the critical illnesses by sheer admission of the ICU, then I think that you can imagine that when the people are sedated, when the people are staying for more than 3 weeks in bed and also being intubated, then pretty much the only thing we can do is the passive motion and the sheer electrical stimulation on the protocol that we showed. These are things that are not rocket science, but they are very important. The sooner you start with the treatments of the ICU, the better the patient will come out of the ICU. And I hope that came over well to you. So this is for me. Thank you very much for listening. Ladies and gentlemen, it was nice to communicate with you on such a great level. We have so many people that that listen to this webinar. I wish you all very good health and also for your families. And I hope to see you the next time on the next webinar. Thank you again.
Okay.
Okay, so the last part of this webinar is, of course, another round of questions. So we will open the lines up again. And again, people, if you are, if you go to your profile, then on the right side, you can find the microphone and you can ask for permission to ask a question.
On the chat, with two questions.
Okay.
Three. One of Marcelo Castaldi.
Yeah.
How do the delivery time change general?
The delivery time?
Yeah.
I don't know what is meant with the delivery time.
Well, maybe if Marcelo would like to explain.
Marcelo, we know that you have a question. Could you come in on the microphone so that we can discuss your question? Would that be possible? There is a...
But it's not Marcelo?
No.
Will we first answer Wawan's question?
Please, can you activate Wawan? Wawan, I think your microphone is activated right now, so please let me hear your questions.
Oh,
you left already. Okay, there's another one.
We have a question of Francis Ngunta.
Yeah, Francis, we will activate your microphone. Please come in with your question.
He's already left. Oh, no, sorry.
Francis, can you hear us?
Francis,
are you there?
Live. No. Other question. Mehul Patel.
Yes, please.
Oh, yes,
also.
Sorry.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, you must understand this is also our first time that we do this webinar. We see all kinds of people coming in with questions and then leaving our platform again. So we try to do what is possible to make the people ask their questions. But now everybody is out.
Okay.
So I take it that everything was clear. Obviously, every one of you can communicate with your Enrofnonius partner, with the sales managers, Marcos, Wim, Josef.
I have two questions still.
Oh, we still have two questions.
I wrote it down from the chat. So of Anwar Gaia. A remark, respiratory muscles aren't able to be stimulated by Enrofnonius machines.
Yeah, this is a very good question. I will repeat the question so that maybe everybody can hear them. Obviously, there is a lot of respiratory muscles, but it is very difficult to stimulate them because we have been discussing this on Friday, but we couldn't get the right information. And most of all, I think by now all of you know that we are always working with evidence-based protocols and evidence-based medicine. So in that sense, we could not even find good protocols to expand the thorax. And also, you must imagine that as soon as you breathe in, also the diaphragm is a very important muscle that will also assist in breathing very severely. As you can imagine, we have 12 ribs and on each side. And between all those ribs, there are very small muscles that are also assisting in breathing. Further to that, we have the trapezius muscles, the scalene muscles, etc. So this is a whole chain of muscles that are working there. And we will try to find knowledge on this. But it's a very good question. We were discussing it on Friday, but I regret that I cannot answer this question fully. So, but thanks for your question.
Okay. Conchita Pratjuk asks for the protocol 482. Is there a pre-program?
The 482, it depends a little bit on what version, but I think the versions of the last 20 years are all able to pre-program and also to, for instance, the last four and the last six series are all sequential programming machines. So in that sense, you can do the pre-treatment, the warming up phase with the 5 hertz current and a tolerable intensity. You can do that with the new 4 series, with the older 6 series, and from what I understand, we could even do it with the old 4 series, but I'm not 100% sure now. But Chonchita, I will make sure that I will get this information to you as soon as possible.
Another question. Uwe Burning?
Yeah, Uwe, yeah.
Why is active pulse time aim? Aim. Why?
The active pulse time?
Active passive is aim. Aim. Even groot, denk ik, tot
je. Ja. Yeah. Uwe, I heard that you have your question. I do not really understand your question now, but I will give you a call this afternoon just to discuss it, because I don't understand the 1-1 pulse.
Okay. Dennis Tai.
Dennis.
Do you use the protocol in early and in-house rehab only?
No, Dennis, if you go back, thank you for your question, Dennis, and no, because you saw also in the time frame is that electrical neurostimulation is used in every phase of the timeline. So in that sense, you can still do it when the muscles are still weak, also in the second and third phase, then NMES is still indicated. So yes, you can all the time continue with electrical neuromuscular stimulation.
Oh, there's a question from Quan Hongi.
Yeah, from Shanghai.
Oh.
And it's gone.
And it's gone again.
Okay.
Sorry. Then, Uwe Burning sent another question. Stim time is as long as pulse time, but you are calling him this afternoon.
Yeah.
Okay, so then we leave that. We tried to connect with Quan Hongi again. It's not working. Mustafa Sarioglu asks, is it possible to use the Sonopuls S84-492 instead of the 484?
Yes, no, that's right. You are now saying two machines, the S84?
Ja.
En de 482?
Of 492 instead of 484.
I think so. Yes, you can also use the tensbed S84 or 82. The thing is with the S, then it would be preferable to use the S84. As you have two muscles on the quadriceps bilaterally and two muscles on the calf bilaterally. So in that sense, you always need 4 channels with 8 electrodes. And as soon as you can do that, then it's perfect. If you use, for instance, the 492, you have a perfect endomet, because the endomet is also within this Sonopuls 492. It's somewhat of a downfall that you then only have to do one pair of muscles and then afterwards the second pair of muscles. It's doable. The machines are all there. We sold thousands of those. So in that sense, every machine that has a tense-related modality can be used for this. Whether it's programmable, that is the question. The older the machine is, the less programmable it is. But I think with the latest, with the last 20 years of Enrafdoni's machines, it will all be possible.
I see that Timor sent the question by the chat. Can we use Tensmed S82 or P82 for rehabilitation on COVID-19? Kind of same question.
Okay, it's the same question. The S82 would be ideal because it's particularly for muscle stimulation. You can use also the P82, but it is somewhat limited in modalities in terms of muscle stimulation, because the P stands mainly for pain management. So this machine has particularly more influence on pain management instead of muscle stimulation. So if you have a S82, it would be perfect. If it is a P82, you have to program I think there is one stimulation program, and there is a possibility to make a manual programming. So it is possible, but it is a little bit more complicated than, for instance, the 484, the EndoMed 484.
Okay. No questions anymore. Maybe you can ask if anyone wants to ask something more. They can write it on the chat.
Yeah. So when there are any more questions, then please let us know. Like I said, you can always contact your sales manager or our departments. We are always there for you. I think there is a couple of things that I didn't understand because, sometimes you do expect questions. Sometimes they are different from what you expected. But still, I hope that and trust that the sheer platform that we created is beneficial to for you in order to communicate with your...
There's another question of Asli Erdogan. Does the microwave devices have an effect in COVID-19 treatments?
Good morning, Asli. Good question. I don't think that there is a scientific proof. And the microwave I'm not sure if that has a possibility in order to do anything. We are working with Chinese universities at the moment to see what the CuraPulse is doing in terms of COVID-19. But obviously it will take so long before we can come up with any scientific reviews on that. But at least we have some communications with our universities, with our professors even, with some Chinese universities. But as we speak about scientific studies, you know already that it will take many years before you can come up with a valid data. So we have to wait, Asli.
Okay, there's another question. Dr. Mayank Takar?
Yeah, Dr. Mayank.
Do you mean we can use NMS for intercoastal MS stim, or by any chance have this been used? Or can we use NMS for breathing enhancements with any particular protocol or any research in same line?
Mayank, good afternoon for you in India. This is basically what we were just answering also in the previous question. At this moment, we are not sure if there is anything possible with the breathing muscles and specifically not with, can we expand the thorax on a thoracic electrode positions. We do not have these very long electrodes, but there is no science on it, so it's very difficult to ask this question. I think when you look at the TENS protocol for the stimulation of the calves and the quadriceps muscles, it's just a very simple neuromuscular electrical stimulation protocol. So in that sense, if you have a TENS modality, it can be done.
I have a question of Ari Murti Sutisna.
Yeah.
Hans, sorry if I ask a question that's not related to this webinar, but last time I saw an email from you regarding some brands for cleaning during this COVID-19 that can be covered under warranty. What happens if those brands are not available locally? Can you still use other brands that are not listed? Thank you.
This is a very good question, Ari, and I will explain also to the other people. I send a list to all the distributors with the possible detergents for the couches, because the sky cannot hold every detergent or every disinfector, because the sky will somewhat deteriorate if you use a lot of alcohol. Ari, I think that the sheer chemical substrate is available in Indonesia. I'm not worried about that, but also that I will see to it that I will search it out for you. And on the other end, if it's not possible, then you must just use whatever is possible, as long as it has a 70% alcohol percentage, But then obviously we also need to discuss the warranty issues, because you know that the sky will deteriorate. So I hope that answers your questions. I'll get back to you about this.
I have a question from Amina. How are we going to explain to our clients that Enrov is the best choice to heal coronavirus?
Okay, so the question I have to say a very political answer now, because obviously we cannot cure corona, because as long as there is no vaccine, there is no cure. So that is difficult. But what we are absolutely the best in is doing the trajectory rehabilitation in the phases of the COVID-19 disease. So that means that that there is a lot of products available in every phase of the corona disease. We will also discuss the medical training therapy in the next webinar. That means that now we focused on the ICU treatments with the electrical neurostimulation. But of course, in the next phases, where we see low intensity training, where we see medical training therapy in the advanced phase, then of course we will also discuss about how can we perform the medical training with the cardio machines, with the treadmill, with the endynamics. And of course you will think, hey, but I can do that also with Technogym and with other products. But do never forget that we are a medical company. All our products are according to the MDD, which means that another very important thing is that you cannot just go and train people. You have to do very good intakes. You have to really look at the level of what this patient is capable. And it is for every single patient, it's another trajectory. So in that sense, with our software, with our intake possibilities, with the tests that we can do standardized in our machines, I think there is a wonderful opportunity to have these people tested, to take a look at their moment, and a week later, after all the treatments that you have done, you can see the results from week to week, make a trend report, send it back to your doctors and specialists. And I think that is a huge difference between the fitness machines. Fitness machines are for healthy people. Our machines are for these people. So do never forget that.
She likes to know which brands are the best.
Which
in
brands?
This case.
Well, I was already, when we are looking at the ICU state, if you ask what machines are the best, then I would for sure deploy the Endomed 484, because you can do the treatment specifically on the ICU in one time, and everything can be very secure and can be even disinfected. We can get you with the right protocols. We can set you up with the right protocols. So in that sense, I would say that the Endomed 484, which was introduced at the Medica, would be the ideal machine. So ladies and gentlemen, thank you again for listening. I hope that I will see you at the next webinar, where we go in detail, like how can you do this evidence-based medical training therapy. And until then, stay safe.
Okay, Hans, well, thank you very much for this very interesting webinar. And thank you all attendees for participating in our first webinar. Please be aware that many of these will still follow, and you can see how interesting it is sharing all this information and seeing all the devices which are already available to help the COVID-19 patients in their rehabilitation. Please be aware that this webinar will be available to you on YouTube in the next coming days. In case you have any more questions, of course, please contact Hans or contact your sales manager at Enrov Nonius. And that's leaving me you just with the question that please you, your friends, your family, your colleagues, be safe and be with us next time again. Thank you so much and goodbye.